Hi-ho, this is Kaz Derisk, and welcome back to Kopi Podcast, episode 43. I am one of your hosts, Kaz Derisk, joined live by Zach Risk here on twitch.tv/KopiGaming. Mr. Kopi himself, Zach, say hi.
Did you hear that? That was the sound of the switch.
Little switch naps, and actually, it may have happened very closely. We have a video playing of the switch, and you got very close to it, actually, I think. So
that's epic.
Okay, so we are recording this the morning after the Nintendo Switch presentation that was held on January 12th.
After Switchmas.
In Tokyo. I think it was actually January 13th in Tokyo, but it was the 12th for us or something. I don't know.
Yep.
It was always weird. I'd get so confused because there'd be all these advertisements that were like, it's on the 13th. And I'm like, no. Like, I have it circled on five different calendars in my house. It's on the 12th. I know that for sure. But it was just because of time and weird things like that. And I was actually very surprised. It was a presentation out of Tokyo, and it was very Japanese. Like, I thought it was going to be more direct-y, like more like a direct, you know, with like cuts to Bill Trennan and Reggie and then Kimishima maybe, but then also, you know, a developer and all pre-scripted and pre-recorded. But no, it was full-out E3 PlayStation experience.
Yeah, it was definitely more of like a classic E3 presentation. Like going back to 2006, like the last time they kind of had one of these sort of things. I don't know. I think it's been about that long. I don't know when they officially stopped, but maybe that was more like 2010, 2011 or something when they officially like just went full direct around the Wii U era. But yeah, like they hadn't had maybe like a classic style presentation like that for quite a while. So definitely a return to form there with that.
Yeah, and I mean, they didn't really have too many bells and whistles. Like, you know, you didn't have Miyamoto come out on stage with a, you know, freaking Link and, you know, Master Sword or whatever.
Yeah, we didn't get Miyamoto. We just got kind of a little cameo, but.
Yeah, like, but that was definitely, I think, pre-scripted and pre-recorded.
Yeah.
Like, I don't even think that was like a live feed from New York. I think that was pre-recorded. But I think the actual presentation itself, if I'm being honest, I don't know if it was the absolute best. I mean, it wasn't terrible, but you had some weird translators. We'll talk about that maybe later. But we have a lot to talk about, so I don't know if we're going to have time to dish into the terrible translator. But, I mean, you had some weird translations, or not necessarily translations, but those kind of moments that you have during traditional E3 press conferences where it's just like that awkward kind of like, when you have someone nervous on stage, it just ruins the whole thing. It's like, all right, like, I don't even care what game you're talking about now. It's just, you're weird. Which you usually avoid with, like, a Nintendo Direct. And I always praise Nintendo for their Directs because I'm like, this is way better than anything PlayStation or Xbox does. Like, just, the Directs are awesome. I do like a live stage show, but I don't know. Even the best stage show, I think, is something like PlayStation's E3 this past year where it was basically just a Direct.
Yeah,
with someone coming out to do the transitions. And so, which I guess this kind of was, because you had that Iwata-looking feller that was doing all the Joy-Con stuff, and that was all, you know.
Yeah, they kept kind of switching to different presentation little videos.
Switching.
Yeah, but and it was very much like that PlayStation E3 of this past year. And they did, I guess they had a few little demonstrations, but not too much. I mean, really came out and did a little Splatoon 2 pose and, but I did think they did.
Yeah, that guy was weird.
I thought they did a great job. Like for example, with, ARMS, when they were demoing that game, they had the guy and he did demonstrate on the stage, like how it works, but they had a video playing simultaneously next to him. That was a pre-recorded one of it, just like working fine, which I thought that's a good idea, a good approach, because so frequently during those live demonstrations, there's a cringe, like something has to go wrong with it not really moving to the left when he's moving, you know, and they've had several of those at Nintendo events when like Wii Music and Zelda Skyward Sword was shown off. That was one of those examples where it was just like nothing was really working out at that moment, and so to do it in kind of those mashup of pre-recorded with live in using those together, I thought that was pretty effective. So, but yeah, there's definitely a lot of areas where they did, I think, everything right, and there was a lot of things where I think there was a lot of negative too, and there was a lot of what they did wrong. So there's a lot to talk about and unpack with it. There's a lot of mixed reactions going around online. There's a lot of
people surprisingly hyped, I'm surprised how many I know it shouldn't be surprising because it's the internet and Nintendo, so just a perfect storm for negativity with, you know, video game communities. But I'm very surprised at how many people are, like, blatantly saying, like, I'm actually not pre-ordering it, and not, like, you know, didn't win me over, but, like, almost, like, there's just really no reason to. And I guess, honestly, if you have a Wii U and you're not, like, if you have a Wii U and you're not, like, a diehard Nintendo fan to the point, like, where you want the newest and greatest technology, there's really not too many reasons to get one at launch.
Right.
Because you can play Zelda on your Wii U, and it looks, I think, very similar, I bet. I mean, we don't know full details of that. And then the next major game is Mario Kart Deluxe, which you can play that on your Wii U.
Mm-hmm.
Then Splatoon 2, maybe by then you kind of want the sequel, but even then you still have Splatoon on the Wii U. So really the first time you really need a Switch is by the holiday for the new Mario.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's when most will sell. I think that's when a lot of people are like, I mean, because people saying they're not pre-ordering it, they're not dissing the console. They're just dissing the launch and the initial, like, first half of the year.
Yeah.
But they say, you know, like, they're totally going to get it by Mario.
Well, and this could be a great thing for, like, a marketing strategy for them. Like, maybe they're intending to have, I mean, because a lot of people were giving them gripes about this $300 price point, saying that's just ridiculous. It should have been $200 to $250, but a lot of people are also criticizing them, saying that was unrealistic from the get-go. Like, I think people saying $250 to $300 for a deluxe bundle, that was the more realistic kind of scenario. Unless they sold one separately, like without the dock, there was that possibility of something like that going on, like a super light version. But I think, like, perhaps they have that strategy of releasing the unit in March, like as soon as they can, for the full $300 price point, and all those diehard fans and all the scalpers and all the people in the frenzy who eat it up will give them some profit in that area, so that at the holiday they can do those Black Friday deals and get those deals
out.
There's
going to be a bundle with the Mario. There's going to be a bundle that has, like, Super Mario Odyssey, and there's going to be, like, it's going to come with, like, a red and blue Joy-Con that looks like Mario's overalls or something, you know? Like, they're going to do all that.
Yeah.
That's the nice thing. We were talking about it earlier. Actually, maybe it's a little bit, it's not necessarily true for the same reasons I said earlier, but I said in a previous Kopai podcast, like, it's brilliant that they can do all these different Switch Joy-Con controllers with different colors and different variations without making you need to buy a whole new unit. Like, you can just buy the new, basically the controllers, which does kind of change your console. Like, the console really is, for the most part, the controller. In a lot of ways, it's weird actually how much they put into the controllers, considering there is a multi-touch screen. But let's actually pump the brakes for a moment.
Okay.
And what I have here, what I have pulled up, is the Kopai Gaming Twitter account. You can follow us on Twitter at Kopai Gaming. I live tweeted the whole Nintendo Switch event, and I missed some things in between announcements. It went over my head that the Fire Emblem was a Fire Emblem Warriors. I just thought it was a new Fire Emblem game kind of being teased.
Yeah.
I missed the whole Warriors word or whatever. I just saw tweets later because I was looking down at my phone and tweeting the really big things.
Yeah.
And like with Mario, for example, I tweeted out, like, there's a new Mario. That's all I'm going to say because, like, I want to watch this.
Mm-hmm.
And so I figured we can go through my live tweets and now kind of give us a recollection of what happened during the night. I have some B-roll pulled up here that we can switch in between to give the audience a little taste of what we're talking about. For now, I just have the generic Switch presentation kind of feature highlight reel going. So, 13 hours ago, tweeted out, live tweeting the Nintendo Switch presentation begins now. Join us on Twitch for our initial thoughts after the show. Countdown, let's go. I was super hyped. The screens are red now. They just went full Coca-Cola. And then I said, and we can talk about this for a moment, President Kimishima is on the stage. Finally, we see and hear this man. And so I thought that was super cool that we had Kimishima finally take the stage. I was really happy that he decided to do it. He's very businessy. It seemed like, you know, what you would expect out of a traditional press conference and a press briefing, it's hard to forget, or it's easy to forget that sometimes, that, you know, these even E3 to an extent. It's not, it's entertainment and it's a show, but it's also like, all right, we need to get down to the nitty gritty here because we do have shareholders that need to know what's happening. And so it does have to be businessy. I pointed out that Kimishima is talking about everything we already know, but it's all good. The hype is too real. Mm-hmm. And so yeah, he kind of just did a recap of everything. And then the first big drop is that Nintendo Switch launches on March 3rd. Hashtag Nintendo Switch presentation.
That was mind-blowing. Kaz was wrong. Yeah. Wait, sorry. Yeah, Kaz was wrong.
Yeah, I said I was wrong because I thought it was good. I thought it was the 17th. Like, almost, I was like 90% confident, you know. As sure as I was sure that Hillary was going to win. And, you know, I was confident it was March 17th.
I was pretty confident, too, about that. And I was thinking it's either going to be that or it might even be later. Like, I was thinking maybe later in the month, like a March, I don't know, 20, like in the week, maybe that Tuesday or maybe even that Friday later, whatever that would be. It would probably be like the 26th or something. But, like, I was really worried because I'm going out of town on that vacation trip sort of thing that week. And I really wanted to take the Switch with me and try it out on the road and do all that kind of experimenting. So it's like, it's going to be way ahead of that date now. So I'll have tons of hands-on time and be probably pretty deep into Zelda at that point. So
yeah, I'm excited because it comes out. We talked about it last night in our initial reactions, but my spring break, I'm kind of finishing up my college studies here. My spring break is March 6th to, I think, like that, the week of March 6th, which means March 6th is a Monday, so that means the 5th is the Sunday, 4th is the Saturday, and then the 3rd is that Friday, basically the first afternoon of my spring break. You know, I get out of classes, spring break begins that weekend, even though spring break is the 6th. And, I mean, they give you, I think, 9 skips for your class, 9 absences you can take. And
really?
Finally meet with the class.
For each class?
For each Monday, Wednesday, Friday class.
Oh, okay.
It depends. Because then Tuesday, Thursdays, you get 6 skips. And once a week classes, you get 3 skips.
That's so crazy. Yeah, we get two absences always, like, that you get 2 skips for every class. Gosh. And that's it.
You can miss with my school's policy. With a Monday, Wednesday, Friday class, you can miss 3 weeks of class.
That's crazy.
Like three full weeks.
That's insane.
And I use them all too. I always use them.
Yeah. Well, yeah, I use my two, but wow.
That explains why you always have, like, you're always talking to me about how you like have such good attendance. And I'm like, man, why is he always going to class? Like, use your skips, man. But that explains it. You only have 2 of them.
Yeah. Well, some people don't seem to really care about that, but I mean, what they do is they have, I mean, you can skip more. It just starts to take out of your overall grade and stuff.
Yeah.
So
yeah, no, you're unaffected with these 9. Some professors give you bonus credit.
That's insane.
Yeah. I mean, I think I missed a whole week once. Like, I just didn't go for a week because of spring break or something, or not spring break. I think it was like Thanksgiving break, and we only had Thursday and Friday off, and I just took off the whole week. Like, I'm like, no, I'm not going.
Yeah.
And so, but yeah, it's super nice. So yeah, I'll probably take off that Friday for sure.
Yeah, I have to if I'm legitimately, like, I have to save them for when I'm really not feeling great.
No, I'll just decide one day to sleep in. Like, I'm like, nope, not going. Yeah. So anyway, though, but yeah, so I get that Friday. I'll probably take that Friday off because I pre-ordered last night, stayed up till 2:30 a.m. I pre-ordered off of Amazon. I got my Switch.
Yeah.
And I was one of the very first ones because Amazon actually didn't list it. They listed it, how they have that little eBay function at the bottom where it's like you can buy from these other sellers. That actually updated before the actual product page, and I clicked that and it was like, it's available from these other sellers, amazon.com, and so they were listed as an other seller first, and so I clicked that, clicked pre-order, and it pre-ordered me through Amazon well before it was even available on the main Amazon page. And so that's how I pre-ordered it, and like everyone in the Now in Stock website were like, guys, go. It's actually, I think it's sold out now on Amazon.
Yeah.
No word on the neons with Amazon though. So maybe they're going to get some neon.
Everything appears to be sold out at this point. Basically it's like Switches everywhere. The master editions of Zelda, even the special ones. I think Breath of the Wild itself isn't sold out, like just the normal edition, but that's basically all you're going to find.
Yeah. I got the master edition of Zelda pre-ordered, and I also pre-ordered the special edition first. because that was the first one that was made available by Amazon. And I think I'll just get, I mean, I think we're just going to ship that to you.
Although this, yeah, this should all be noted, I guess, that it's all online that we're talking about. So perhaps you could be going to like your Walmart or GameStop locally and asking if they have.
Yep. Go check them out if you're trying to get a pre-order for the Switch.
Because once we finish this, I'm seriously considering like calling up GameStop and saying, "Do you have like limited pre-orders of this Master Edition? Like,
yeah, that
possible?"
Yeah, definitely.
Because I'm not.
I'd call as far as Lincoln, because that store is going to be cool. You know, like you're going to want. I think that sword eventually, but
yeah,
I mean, and they'll sell separately. People will probably just sell the sword.
And yeah, I was thinking about that too, and I was also thinking about surely somebody's going to have maybe make a sort of Breath of the Wild inspired or replica Zelda special edition, maybe a bigger sword or a collector's edition. Like, there's going to be so much merch that's probably going to be like jumped on for this game that hopefully something will work out. But in the end, I'm like thinking, I don't know. I can't. I'm trying not to get like too bummed out about that. There's so much cool, like that collector's.
Oh yeah, no, I think stuff, this. But I mean, honestly, I just want the special edition. I really want the special edition for that Sheikah Slate case.
Yeah, that's what I was
for my Switch tablet. The map is going to be awesome. The little collector's coin.
Definitely.
The sword's going to be cool. I'll put the sword up like next to my Nathan Drake or something. Like, it'll be a fun little accessory.
Yeah.
But it's nice that the special edition has everything else still. Wish it had a steel book though.
I love those maps that like Skyrim comes with and The Witcher and stuff. It's like those are perfect to put up, especially when you're like really immersed in those games, and to have like nearby your TV or where you usually sit, so that you can look up to it and kind of study it as a world that you're living in and a part of. And those things are just really awesome, especially the more authentic ones. Like, this seems to put a lot of care into it with the special parchment feel that it has. Like, I'm not sure if you were watching the Treehouse coverage, but Reggie was showing it off. And yeah, it looks really good. And then it has the story of the Calamity Ganon on the back, and really, really cool stuff.
Yeah, definitely. So that's exciting.
And the new box art, too, I think we should point out, is so beautiful and so much better than that placeholder ugly crap that...
Oh, yeah. Yeah, the box art for all the games.
They were like, this is the real box art. You guys are crazy. Get used to it. This is Zelda, Link pulling his bow back. That's going to be the...
this. Yeah, and like just like the generic pattern background. Yeah, it was ridiculous. Moving on, because we only have a half hour left. So then there was the big drop that it will cost $300. Only one so far available version for the 300. Well, you have the neon version and the gray version. $300 though, great price point. I was watching it with my wife and she was like, "Wait, it's $300 and it comes with the two controllers, basically, like the two individual Joy-Cons," which themselves are like, a pair of Joy-Cons is like $80.
Yeah.
Plus you have your docking station. Like, I mean, the $300, I wonder how much of a profit they're making.
$80 for the two Joy-Cons, and then we got the $90 for just the docking station alone. And so
So the tablet must be like only $100 or so.
Well, I mean, that's 80 and 90, so that's $170. And then I would think the units, gotta be, I would think it's over 100 for the actual like tablet itself.
Yeah, if it's an HD 60 frames per second tablet that also has multi-touch and it's able to process something like The Legend of Zelda inside the actual tablet, that's got to be a pricey little tablet.
Well, and you heard that it's supposed to be playing 1080p 60 frames a second on the docked, and then 720 and 60 frames per second still off. Which is amazing.
And I think one of the major reasons I think the only reason it's 1080 on the dock isn't necessarily because it's getting fed a ton of extra power from the docking station. I think it's just simply because the tablet itself can't do 1080.
Right. It just it's like if you plug your device into a smaller TV that's not capable of. Yeah, definitely. And I think that 720p on a small screen like that's beautiful. And I also think, like, we were talking a bit about the size comparisons to like Vita and stuff, and seeing it in people's hands, I don't know, it just looks like it's got that screen, just seems,
it's bigger. It's, someone posted a picture, it's bigger than a 3DS XL when it's folded. Like it's almost actually very similar to the 3DS XL size. If you hold your 3DS XL, but then put like two Wiimotes next to it, it's about that size. So probably very similar to the Wii U gamepad.
So it's a little I don't know. It's hard.
Screen's
I guess.
Probably a little bit bigger, but the overall tablet size is probably about the gamepad.
The Vita seems very like slim and kind of small, I have to. My 3DS XL is across the room, so I can't really get a good judgment, a size judgment. But it is a pretty, like, it's a decent screen size. Like, it's going to be really nice.
Yeah.
And I think that, definitely. I don't know. Every time I see it, the screen seems bigger than what the inch size, like, the specifications actually say it is. Like, something about it. And the resolution or how they've stretched the screen size, I don't know.
The Joy-Cons look a little clunky on the side. I was saying that, like, when I saw, like, a picture of, like, an actual product page of it.
Yeah.
Like, with the Joy-Cons, like, they looked a little bit like they're just, like, two big fat ears on a tablet. Like, the rest of it was super sleek, but the tablet, like, they looked kind of weird. I love the colored versions, though. I really do. And I love, like, the little clips you can put on and make them basically, like, thicker Wiimotes, basically.
Mm-hmm.
Really exciting accessories. Like, they're really milking the accessories. So, moving on to the Twitter, the Nintendo Switch online service connects with your phone. Seems very nifty. I was going to talk about this a little bit. I think we're going to have to, like, have a whole separate discussion on what we think about the Nintendo Switches and Nintendo's online infrastructure moving forward, because it seems to be mirroring the PlayStation Network in the most perfect way possible, in a way I didn't think they were actually going to be able to accomplish. But minus trophies and achievements, it seems as if they have everything the major, you know, players have as far as online infrastructure goes. And beyond that, it seems like they may even be one-upping them. Because, I mean, it seems like they're making it solely based on your smartphone and apps.
Mm-hmm.
And almost all of the online stuff is completely absent from the Switch itself. The Switch simply connects to all of that through, you know, just local connection or whatever.
Right.
But it's your actual smartphone doing the connecting. The nice thing about that is, like, I mean, the PlayStation app, I think, is terrible. Like, it's clunky. It crashes. It takes forever to load. Like, I don't like the PlayStation app. And I don't use Xbox, so I can't speak to that. But it's nice that, I mean, you're able to manage your Nintendo accounts very remotely from your phone, even to the point where you can track your game time. We have, I can pull up here, the Nintendo Switch parental control video. They have that there where it's just, you'll see in this video, they have the ability to block game time and suspend the Nintendo Switch console from their phone. Like, to have that amount of power from a phone, like, I know there's games like The Division and Watch Dogs where you have the second app experiences. I play lots of Destiny, and there's apps where you can literally change your inventory from your phone and drag items to another character you have. Like, it's not, you know, brand new. But for Nintendo, and I think just even for modern hardware, to take advantage of that to the point where it's like you can disable a game. Well, I don't like it necessarily for the sake of disabling, you know, your kid's game. Like, that's brutal. Just, you know, you didn't do your homework, you're blocked.
Yeah.
That's pretty hardcore, especially, like, if I wonder how it works with saving. Like, hopefully there's games that have autosave out the wazoo. But just be able to have that infrastructure, combine that with what seems to be an implementation of the just My Nintendo, you're most likely going to be getting daily rewards for playing a game like Zelda, you know. Log into Zelda, play for, you know, a little bit, and you get 20 platinum coins to get a discount on another game. In addition to that, you get a free monthly retro Nintendo game. It's a full-on service that I think is well-fitting for 2016 or 2017 now. I was very impressed with that in a way I didn't think I was going to be impressed after the day. Oddly enough, they didn't spend too much time on it. Like, I'm surprised they didn't even show this Bowser Jr. trailer within the presentation, because it was perfect.
Yeah, it was.
Maybe they just didn't want that to be the focus of the presentation, but people are sharing it afterwards. Like, where was this?
Well,
Nintendo does that a lot.
And they should have mentioned the, you know, this is kind of related with their online service, the whole NES, SNES download every month with this new feature of added online play. So now you're going to be able to play all these classic games online with your friends, which is kind of like the emulation netplay feature. And they didn't even mention that, and that would have probably had people in the crowd applauding and giving a standing ovation, but like because that's one of the
things I'm trying to think. Like, imagine being able to play through, like, we can play through Super Mario Bros. Or something, or I guess that's not SNES, because I think SNES games are the only one with online games.
Yeah.
But I'm trying to think of like a prominent two-player SNES game. Like, what's one that's like very much so two-player? Like, they had Street Fighter as the example.
Yeah. Well, you got like F-Zero. You have the Mario Kart. And you got crap, there's so many like multiplayer, two-player gems probably in the SNES, NES, because you got like Balloon Fight will probably be arcadey games like that. You'll be able to play like Street Fighter showing off. If that's compatible, there's going to be a huge array of games. And I'd love it if they released that Pack Attack game on there, because that game was really fun. That has two players, and that'd be really fun to play together, or like some sort of Tetris Attack, those kinds of games. I don't know. Yeah. There's so many possibilities for that. And bringing back that retro classic style of couch co-op. And
it's going to be insane. Yeah. It's the online stuff is totally awesome.
I bet if you pull up like what SNES games are like two players and what you can do together, it's like so much. And I wonder, what would be interesting is that if it actually allowed for games like Donkey Kong Country or something to be able to play co-op online, because those games, like, it used to be kind of where Tails and Sonic, you could have the other player and you can help each other and some people even do like speed runs that way, where somebody's gonna grab the controller. It's also just fun to like watch along and kind of participate a bit with a friend and have the voice chat to bond in that way. If they could add all these other elements of ways that people can just connect easier and more seamlessly, which seems the route they want to take, there's great opportunity for that. And also, they never confirmed with this conference that Virtual Console GameCube is coming. But if they do announce that, that also opens up like Double Dash and a whole bunch of stuff like that to play on the Virtual Console. So,
Watching this parental control highlight race,
stuff like that.
Yeah, watching this parental control highlight video, I just remembered also, it's going to be very nice that, you know, you can look at, parents are going to be able to look at a list of games. I think it's just going to be kind of a cool thing where they can see how many games, or like what's the most played game for holiday shopping as well. It's going to be kind of cool. They're probably going to implement, you know, some sort of holiday buying guide based on what games you're playing the most. And so, going to be really cool. I just love that feature overall. And I'm just excited to see with that technology, it's like the, you know, Nintendo Switch API or something, what they're going to be able to do with that, just because Nintendo just, you know, can really work with that. Moving forward, Nintendo Switch is talking region locking, and it's no more region locking, which is going to be incredible, because there's really now every game is going to be a worldwide release when you think about it. You may have to, you know, get a Japanese version, but you have a console like the Vita, which is region free, and people are importing Japanese games, Persona, stuff like that all the time, and they just have a constant flow of games because all these games that release in Japan that don't get localized for the West can be pretty fun, and not even really necessarily, like, you don't even really need to know what's going on as far as you can figure out the buttons and the gameplay.
Well, you know what? You know, one of the things I'm most excited about for this feature, somebody pointed this out in one of the comments discussions I was reading they were complaining about how Europe is not getting this master edition of Zelda. And, I just saw the UI for the Switch a little bit. That's so gorgeous. But, somebody was like, Europe probably is, of course, not going to get this edition because of how Nintendo is. They do these, like, they'll get a cool edition for one region, but maybe the next game, the next region gets it. So what's really awesome is, like, Europe all the time is getting these amazing, like, Pokemon bundles and special edition, versions of things of, like, I can see them putting out special Joy-Cons that are only available in Europe. And now these editions are going to finally be able to just be imported and actually work. Before, it was like, you can't import those because those aren't going to work on your system. They're a completely different region. But now, so many, like, really awesome collector's editions will be more worth the purchase because you're not just going to get a game that's like, all right, now I got to resell this. It's like,
yeah,
you can actually get your copy from like Great Britain or something.
Yeah, and I've imported a lot of Amiibo from Japan. It seems like there's always more of an Amiibo stockage in Japan. Like, they just have more supplies usually because, for whatever reason, Reggie doesn't like to have us have things over here. And so that's going to be a nice thing, too. I bet, like, as we move forward and they get more stock in, they'll probably get stock of Nintendo Switches in Japan first before we get more of them in the West. Oh, yeah, there's that video of the UI. And, oh, my gosh, the UI looks so good.
It looks very PS4 in a way.
Yeah, like, oh,
like
my gosh,
PS4 Lite or something. It looks even lighter than the PS4, but it has that kind of – and, I mean, they've kind of –
has a Windows 10 look to it.
Yeah, yeah. I love that. And an iPhone kind of thing, too, with the simplified buttons and everything. It's like they really went with a modern, sleek, simplistic style with it. That's really nice. Really, really nice.
Yeah.
Because before, they've kind of gone with a little bit of a thicker, like, buttony kind of childish, I guess. I don't know the right word for it, but it's like
big fat buttons that are easy to click and easy to look at, you know, something that your grandma can see when she's playing.
But
moving forward, we only have 20 minutes left. I want to talk a little bit about the actual games. We'll have to talk about, you know, the individual games as we get closer. It's actually, I mean, we only have 6 more episodes after this one, I believe, maybe 7. 6 or 7 episodes before we actually have Switch impressions.
That's crazy.
Playing the Switch. And so we'll have to kind of maybe just divide up our shows and plan them out, what we're going to be talking about, you know, and there's going to be other news, but we can probably dissect in each of these individual points for each week, and then we have the Switch. It's going to be so exciting. Some other things I tweeted out, the head of software for the Nintendo Switch is on stage now. It inherited DNA from each Nintendo or previous Nintendo hardware. It's the ultimate Nintendo America console with every bit of Nintendo's past. Time for a presentation trailer. Nothing but Zelda and play so far. Ooh, new Mario Kart footage. Let's talk about that real quick. I have some Mario Kart 8 deluxe footage here. We don't need to talk too much about this because it is Mario Kart 8, but very cool that they're bringing in more characters.
Yeah.
Very much so revised battle mode.
I suspect, the battle mode, adding that and like refining that is really, really awesome because that was a huge detriment to the original and people were so disappointed about that. And now it adds, like we were talking last night, it adds basically a whole other game element to it that people will actually be interested in and they'll actually use frequently. You know, it's not like Smash Tour or something. It's like people are actually going to be using this all the time because some people, I mean, primarily play Mario Kart for this mode and like they were like,
yeah, I didn't realize that until 8, but people, when it was gone, it was one of those things where they're like a vocal minority. They were a silent majority, I guess, the people that played battle mode where you just didn't even know about them out there, but they loved it. I think Nintendo, in the same way, they probably didn't have the technology to track who was actually playing it. They probably just figured no one was. The nice thing about battle mode, especially with the Switch, is that the Switch is so based in bringing it to a party, being Karen, walking onto a rooftop and being like, yo, I got my Switch. You want to battle in Mario Kart. And having that kind of tabletop battling of your Switch or having it, you know, when you're at the airport or whatever. And battle mode lends itself so well to that idea of, you know, just being in an arena and having your little Switch. And so I think that's really nice. It seems like the visuals are pretty much the same, which is actually gave me kind of a little breath of relief or sigh of relief because there is lots of reports. And I don't know if it was maybe the stream quality or what, because rewatching the trailers later, it's not a problem at all. But just the quality sometimes was a little bit lackluster in the presentation. I think it was just because of live streaming. Like, they were live streaming a video that's been compressed, and then we're uploading it to that's been compressed, and then downloading it, it's compressed again, you know. Just lots of opportunity for it to be pretty bad. But seeing that it's on par with the Wii U, that's totally refreshing because it's just like that, the Wii U, when Nintendo develops for it, is absolutely gorgeous. So we'll have to see where that goes.
What it seems to me is that there's, I mean, from what I've kind of, I watched a bit of the Treehouse coverage and there didn't appear to be any new tracks added yet. The game is not a launch title, so I'm suspecting that perhaps
by the time... There are some new tracks.
Oh, there are? Okay.
Yeah, the Nintendo page said which ones. They're bringing back some retro tracks.
Oh, awesome.
And I don't know actually if there's any new tracks, but I know there's new retro tracks.
Because I know I know for sure there's new battle arenas, because there's the Splatoon battle arena, which is obviously new. And so I would assume perhaps there's a Splatoon track itself to go along with that, because all these battle courses are based on other tracks. And so that's definitely a possibility. They could even have a new track for Inklings, a new track for Bowser Jr., and a new track for King Boo, or like some haunted house, and then a retro track to like end it out or something like that. I guess we'll see. But I just suspected that we'd have to get some, because like, what is the, from what I had seen about this whole deluxe, is like there's three new characters, and there's, now you can switch between items. Like, what else is deluxe about it if there's not really...
Switching between items is going to be cool.
Yeah, but I mean, seriously, it's like, okay, you added three new characters and you ported the game over. And you made the battle mode better. That's awesome. But where, like, that's really deluxe. Like, you didn't add one new, like,
I wonder if the
course cup. So it's like, but
yeah,
it seems
EB
it
Games
is.
Leak so. Is true.
What's that?
Where it's that EB Games leak. Remember it said 24 new tracks.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Or something. Although I think that person admitted to just messing around. Mm-hmm. You wonder if they put it out that tweet, though, where they said, oh, I was just playing with Photoshop and trying some new things. You wonder if they did that because they were covering it up. Because I thought it was super weird that their little leak, and I didn't believe it for a second, that their leak was like, it's all new battle mode. Like, yeah, whatever. Like, that's what everyone wants. That's not going to be the focus. Even if there is a new battle mode, that's not the focus of their marketing.
Right.
And it really was. And so I wonder if that guy actually knew something, or maybe, you know, working for EB Games. Moving forward, I'm trying to figure out what the next game to talk about here is so I can get a trailer pulling up for B-roll. New Mario Kart footage. Traditional Mario Kart battle mode is back. The screen is a touch screen, of course, with Wi-Fi functionalities too. They love them Switch puns. You can charge while playing the future. You can hashtag Amiibo with the Joy-Con controller. You can scan Amiibo with the Joy-Con controller. There's also a share button. Finally, you can easily share photos and video of your Nintendo games. We call this sharing the joy. You can go full sloth mode with the Joy-Cons, where you can just have them at your side.
And that's one of the things I'm super, super excited about for this, is just to have that back. Is like,
yeah,
it's gonna be really nice, especially for like virtual console games and stuff. I can just imagine like playing the new Mario. It's like, it's gonna be nice to just lounge and be able to have my hands at my side. Like, that was what I loved.
I loved
about
that
the
with
Wii.
The Wiimote.
Yeah, and so that's great to have back.
Yeah, there are different colored Joy-Cons now. You can play rock, paper, scissors with your Nintendo Switch. And then they showed the first video game trailer, and I said, is this Westworld on the Nintendo Switch? And nope, it was 1-2 Switch. A little Wild West thing that gets pulled up here. But yeah, so this looks like a really fun game. It's essentially the Nintendo Land or Wii Sports of the Nintendo Switch. And actually looks like a lot of fun.
Mm-hmm.
It's feeding off the Joy-Con gimmick. It's feeding off the ability to take your tablet wherever and play with anyone. I would love to do a video series where I go to different colleges or the Mall of America and pull out my Switch, and I'm like, yo, draw. And we just pull out our little Joy-Con guns and stuff and, you know, hand my Joy-Con to someone. Hopefully they don't run away with it. I think it'd be a fun video series to do that. Maybe like hidden camera, you know, where you have like a wireless mic and you're going around and asking people if they want to play 1-2 Switch. I think it sounds fun. So it looks like a super fun party game. I did tweet out, though, it should have been WarioWare, I think, personally. I mean, there's a back and forth debate that, you know, should they use these IP, their old IPs, for some games like this, just kind of shove them in, you know, with like Splatoon. A lot of people thought that should have been Mario, but now people love the Inklings. I tweet out later that, you know, Arms could have been Punch Out very easily, you know, Punch Out Arms or something.
Mm-hmm.
And like, it doesn't even need to have Little Mac in it. I'm just saying it should have had the Punch Out name, because it doesn't change anything, but it's just about the marketing and the branding, which, you know, isn't essentially at the end. Like, all these gamers would say, oh, it's not important if it's, you know, Mario or, you know, Jumpman. Like, it doesn't matter. But at the same time, there's people that walk into a store and they don't they recognize Punch Out from their childhood or something, or they recognize the Punch Out they played on the Wii, or they know Little Mac from Super Smash Bros. And seeing the Punch Out logo and the little boxing glove makes sense to them. Like, I think that's a very important thing. So even though, like, you know, artistic integrity and, you know, just the actual merit and value of it, it's not important. Like, it can be ARMS or Splatoon or whatever. I'm just saying Punch Out or ARMS and the 1-2 Switch could have maybe fed off of traditional Nintendo brands. Like, yeah, I just don't know why 1-2 Switch wasn't WarioWare. Maybe they think the WarioWare brand is weaker than having it just be completely original.
Well, what I'm guessing is that it didn't seem quirky enough, perhaps, to be a WarioWare title. It seemed like they are a lot of genuine little competitive games between just two people, and that WarioWare does have that super zany, lots of different really absurd stuff going on, like plucking, you know, it's kind of that Rhythm Heaven, plucking nose hairs, wiping tears away, blowing your nose.
Yeah, 1-2 Switch could have been Rhythm Heaven too. I think Mango Viking tweeted that at us, where he was like, it should have been something like that.
Mm-hmm.
Or even, you know, Mario Party Switch or something, and just make it 1-2 Switch, but call it Mario Party. But maybe that's bad too. Maybe people don't like the Mario Party brand anymore. I would think the people trying to appeal to, which is families and kind of more casual gamers, I think that would maybe be good for it. But
what it seems to do is, like, I'm seeing people playing it right now on the Treehouse, and it seems to have a Pong-like aspect to it, like an old Atari kind of vibe of super simple games, a little bit like a Pong tennis kind of thing, where on the screen you can kind of see the ball going back and forth or things like that. They just it opens up opportunities for just little co-op two-player experiences that more involve looking your opponent kind of in the eyes or interacting directly with the person in front of you, which it just seems like is kind of a unique experience and kind of can set up for an IP of its own in a way where I could see them possibly releasing like 3-4 Switch or something in a year. Like, maybe they could go.
Yeah, that's true.
Or what was Wii Sports when they did, like,
Resort?
Yeah,
or
yeah. Or so they could do another one down the line, and I think that it has a place to evolve along with it as something new that utilizes the Switch's unique features, and hopefully WarioWare and that team actually does something of their own, so yeah, then we get like the best of both worlds kind of thing.
That's true, yeah. So I tweeted out that ARMS. My initial impressions ARMS was not as hype as 1-2 Switch. I think that's the general consensus online, is people are like, "What's up with ARMS?" Like, I bet it's way. And then I tweeted out, "It's probably way more fun to play than actually watch." Which is probably true, especially I'm thinking with the tactic feedback when it kind of vibrates in your hand, depending on like where you land a punch. I bet that feels great.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I tweeted out they need to be using their treasure IPs with these wacky fun games. Can't wait to see ARMS in esports arenas. You ready, D1? The titling in ARMS is way too literal, LOL. Zelda Universe tweeted out, we have a game where people hit each other with their arms. What should we call it? How about ARMS? And I said, who is the main character dude with springy arms? Springman. So, really fun game, though.
Yeah, well, I saw somebody playing it and demoing it, and what looks really cool, like you said, it probably feels great to get that feedback in the controllers. Like, you reach out, and you can, like, grab your opponent and then pull them into you, and it seems like that's a very satisfying, like, once you actually, if you successfully can reach out and grab them and bring them up and then start wailing on them, it's like, there's really cool combos and stuff you can do.
Yeah, and then they showed a little picture of the Joy-Con controllers going in greater detail. You can find that. I think Amiibo Deals or Amiibo Alerts tweeted that out. Very cool in-depth picture. But then they moved on and they announced Splatoon. And all I tweeted out was hashtag Splatoon. Now is when the real show begins. Let's go, Splatoon. And so they showed the Splatoon trailer. We have that playing for you guys here if you're watching. If you're listening to the podcast on SoundCloud or whatever, you can watch the trailer on Nintendo's page. I said Splatoon looks like more of the same Splatoon we know and love. That's a great thing. Some squid doctor man is talking about fashions and weapons. Splatoon is a proper sequel as it introduces dual wielding. Local multiplayer with Splatoon is going to be such a blast at parties, for real. I wasn't being sarcastic. It's going to be really fun to bring to a party and just play around a Splatoon. Like, that's a, it's like a board game that's just way more in depth than a board game could ever be. And so, just a second, getting some tweets here.
What is this game that they're demoing on the Treehouse right now? It looks so interesting. And it's,
is it like, the snipper clips or something?
Yeah. That's got to be it.
Yeah, we'll have to talk about that maybe next week or something. We're running low on time because I do want to get to... We have Splatoon. That was an awesome announcement, but honestly, not too much to talk about with Splatoon 2. We're going to get more details on that in the future. Awesome, they're bringing back weapon updates, though, and that's just more of the same thing. If you love Splatoon, you're going to love Splatoon 2. Then, though... They got to the next thing. Where do I have it here? Which is Super Mario Odyssey. I tweeted out Watch Dogs Mario. Super Mario Odyssey is too much to handle. Absolutely perfect. More impressions later, but we are freaking out for the time being. And then they have the cordially invited to panic with Bowser and Peach, a royal wedding. Bowser's finally getting married to Peach, which is awesome. Good for him. Very happy for the two of them. Mm-hmm. Ryan McCaffrey tweeted out, holy, Mario Odyssey looks amazing. Oh my gosh, and he was freaking out. And then they tweeted out the official logo. Max Scoville said that it looks awesome. I retweeted them. And then I freaked out that it's holiday. That sucks. That's so far away, simply because like it's not a bad, you know, Nintendo, you're stupid. It's a holiday. Why are you not doing a launch? Like it makes total sense. Mm-hmm. I'm just personally bummed that it's holiday. And honestly, we could probably have a full discussion next week on the analysis of these levels, what we think of the open world, what, you know, we could just have like a, maybe next week, just have a whole Super Mario Odyssey discussion and hype and preview and what we think it can do. Seems, I mean, looks like it may probably have like a level select of some sorts with your little hat spaceship thing. Mm-hmm. Seems very Galaxy 2 in that way.
Yeah.
But then it's a traditional 64 Sunshine Mario. Mm-hmm. In the best possible way.
One of the things...
And so...
Sorry.
Yeah, go ahead. No, you talk about
it. One of the things I thought was really interesting is that I think they did a brilliant job of showing the level that they did in the teaser trailer for the game with the initial Switch reveal that was like... it showed more of a traditional Mario, like... 3D world kind of look, and 64, like a very ambiguous, like hard to tell what exactly style this is. Like they didn't show the city as their tease, you know. It's like we didn't get that reveal until tonight. They showed like so much was hidden that they purposely like held off to this event, which is really awesome. And to keep that a secret too, I thought that was really cool. That, I mean, people haven't spilled the beans on this yet, that they were like, this the next Mario is like has the city of like New York, basically. Like nobody spoiled that, and I thought that was, that's really cool. It was a great surprise and like mind-blowing, and I think that was like where I officially pooped my pants watching the presentation.
Yeah, dude, I just realized too, with the Super Mario Odyssey trailer, that last shot of him running and then he stands on the white background,
yeah,
I think that's the screenshot they use for all of the Super Mario Run branding.
Yeah.
It's like the exact same. And it's, I bet they just use that picture and that Mario model for all of their branding, which is just awesome. Like, that's just, yeah. The detail in him is awesome. It looks like the animations are so cool. The way he runs looks perfect. And they're bringing back the parkour stuff. We're going to have a whole separate discussion on Super Mario Odyssey at a later date. Because it's just, that's just too much to handle. We're trying to get most of this stuff with, like, you know, 1-2 Switch, the Joy-Cons, all of that out with this live show today. But
yeah, well, it's crazy is that it's been too long too. It's like, I mean, since we've had a real, that's why I kind of got teary, is because it's just like, I was just looking at it and it was so magical. And it was just like, it's been so long. Like since Galaxy 2.
Interesting. There's a little flag, like a little tiny Mario flag, like a one of the checkpoint kind of ones in a level.
Because when did Super Mario Galaxy 2 come out?
Uh-huh. It must have been like 2008 or 9, I think. I mean, maybe 10.
Yeah, 2010. May of 2010. So yeah, it's been 7 years since we've had an actual like real 3D kind of exploratory Mario game. So it's been too long, nearly a decade. Yeah. So
just saying though, I mean, maybe, I mean, I don't, I'll be okay without it, but they got to add in my Luigi, my Toad, my Peach, like beat the game and you can rebeat it now as Luigi or something. I don't know
about that.
I think Galaxy 2 you can play as Luigi.
Yeah, that's a good point. Because I think that was also it's originally one of Miyamoto's points is that I think that even in 64 he originally wanted it to be kind of that 3D world style where you can play as all these different characters over again. So it seems like definitely 3D world was amazing. I hope they have 3D world 2 on this alongside Odyssey and stuff, and it's just like the best Mario experiences ever on the Switch, which Odyssey is probably going to be like the pinnacle of all this.
Yeah, it's gonna be incredible. But to close out Kopai Podcast episode 43, our Switch reactions, let's talk about The Legend of Zelda Breath of the Wild, which they ended out the show with. It is releasing on March 3rd alongside the Nintendo Switch. You can try to pick up a pre-order for it now, of the Special Edition or of the Master Edition, but you probably won't be able to, but the game is out there. You can, they also said it's coming to the Wii U on March 3rd, so
yeah.
Same day release date for both of them. It's a launch title for the Nintendo Switch, and it looks gorgeous, the new launch trailer. If you watched the presentation and you didn't like the launch trailer for it, or not the launch trailer, but like the new story trailer, because it was in the Japanese dub and you didn't know what was going on, even with the subtitles, they do have an English version available on Nintendo's English or North America YouTube account, which I actually personally like the English voice acting more. It seems more what I consider, you know, fantasy, you know, dialogue or dialect, you know. Mm-hmm. You kind of have that elvish British sort of vibe. Mm-hmm. Very Game of Thronesy. I liked Zelda's voice a lot more with the English dub. Traditionally I like more Japanese dub, like with Dragon Ball Z and Pokemon. I usually like to listen to the Japanese version and just read the subtitles, but with this game I was a little bit more fond of the English dub. It looks gorgeous. They're continuing to show stuff. Part of me wants to look away because I'm like, I don't want to know what's happening. But at the same time, I'm just like, I want to watch everything I can. Just because it's part of the hype and the experience, just watching it the way they choose to reveal it. Showing the towns and the villages and showing like the different, you know, places where the guardians are. And there's like a place where you have a boat and there's temples and dungeons and towers. It's going to be one of the greatest Zeldas ever. And adding a story to it that really fleshes out, seems like almost a reboot of the series, because it seems to take place after any sort of Zelda timeline. Like, it's just like, okay, this is our new timeline, our new place. They have that shot of Zelda in the bathtub there, or whatever. I'm like, it's getting a little spicy, yeah. A little feisty for my taste. I don't know. Like,
I dug it.
I don't know. You dug it?
Yeah. All
right. Get behind it. I do like, though, how Zelda and Link are twinning throughout most of the game. There seems to be that classic, you know, I don't know. It's an awesome game. We're going to have a whole separate Zelda discussion also in the future. And so much to unpack. You got the Gorons back. You got the big Gorons. You got these temples. You got the Great Fairy back. You got Epona, whatever you want to call her or him. You got Falco just hanging out. You got the Zoro people. It's just
you got it all.
It's
like,
I think someone spotted Beetle or something, like the guy that, you know, is in Wind Waker and in Skyward Sword. He's like hanging around like in each Zelda game selling stuff. Like, I think they got him back, and it's just,
play Skyward Sword, which would probably really influence my opinion about this, but I did think of like how I did play and complete Ocarina of Time, and then playing a lot of Twilight Princess, I felt that kind of...
You beat Wind Waker too, though, didn't you?
Pretty much. I got to the very end of Wind Waker and never actually went through with completely finishing it, which I really regret, but one day I'm going to, because I like I don't mind replaying Zelda games either and stuff, so... But I was just thinking, like, in terms of Twilight Princess, I thought it took that formula of Ocarina of Time and made it the definitive kind of story of Zelda and the Legend of Zelda, and this new one seems like it's basically doing that exact same thing. It's kind of Ocarina of Time, Twilight Princess, just the Legend of Zelda, and even since the very first game, and it's because it seems like sometimes they kind of do these side things. Even I'm not sure if Skyward Sword was a little bit, but it seemed a little bit to me like it was kind of not as much of just a direct Ocarina of Time sort of inspired thing. It seemed like even Wind Waker in a bit was kind of side-ish. Like, it did have a very big open exploratory world and stuff, but it wasn't just that, like, retelling, kind of like how Star Fox does, where it's just that same kind of story, but retold better. Again, it's like Star Wars does, but this seems like the next, like, Ocarina of Time 3 or 4 or whatever it is of this the franchise. It's like, this is the mind-blowing huge exploration, do anything you want kind of Zelda that or Ocarina originally was and Twilight expanded upon. And this is like, what's crazy to me is that this, I feel, almost makes, like, Skyrim look super stiff in comparison, I felt. Like,
I thought so, too. Like, I thought so, too. I was super excited when Todd Howard came on. We didn't get a chance to talk about that, but, hey, what's up, Todd? Like, it was really cool when he came on. And also, shout out to Bill. Bill, come on the show.
Bill!
But I thought it was kind of, it was, watching the Skyrim trailer, maybe it's just because Skyrim is, what, 6 years old now?
Right,
like,
yeah.
It's a six-year-old game coming
versus,
to this.
Versus 2017 game.
Yeah, like, and so it's just, I mean, that it's a little, you know, apples and oranges.
But I mean,
in that
we
regard.
Also saw this, I think, first in 2011 or something like that. When was this first?
It couldn't have been that because Skyward Sword came out in 2012.
Oh,
so
okay, yeah, that's
this cool. is probably though a 2013 game, a 2014 game, and so it is a few years old too. But yeah, no, I mean, I was gonna say this to kind of close out the show. We do have to wrap up here. You mentioned that, you know, you haven't played Skyward Sword. I think a lot of people missed out on that one because it was at the tail end of the Wii era. But I will say this. You have 7 weeks now between now and the Nintendo Switch
That's
launch
true.
And the launch of Breath of the Wild. If anyone listening also has
also
played
on
Skyward
Virtual
Sword.
Console.
It's on Virtual Console. You can also probably pick up a physical copy. You know, I think they're pretty much full retail price still, like $50 or $60. But it's, I think, $20 on Virtual Console.
That's what I was thinking. If it's cheaper on that, I might just have to go that route just for that convenience factor and everything.
Yeah, I mean, you have your Amiibo on the shelf. People know you're a Zelda fan. But I think Skyward Sword is a must-play between now and Breath of the Wild if you haven't played it, simply because it does so much groundwork for, I think, the Hyrule lore and land.
Yeah.
And if you, I mean, especially with you have enough distance between you and the TV, I think the motion controls work pretty well for you. I was so close to my TV that they were very frustrating.
Mm-hmm.
And just because I have my small dorm room that I was living in at the time. And so you'll probably enjoy the game even more than I did. And I did like the game, but in spite of all the controls, that I actually hated the controls with a passion.
Yeah. I need to finish Twilight, too, because that's actually one that I've really been thinking about lately, going back and rewatching that cutscene video again to get myself, like, back to where I was and into that story, which I haven't totally lost. And I did also write a journal somewhere about, like, where my progress was so I could come back at some point, but need to do that.
I need to write a Breath of the Wild journal. Yeah, I'm excited to do Let's Plays that whole week with spring break. I'm going to get live stream up Breath of the Wild. Maybe do a 24-hour live stream because it's my spring break. Let's play Breath of the Wild for 24 hours.
Oh, that's going to be amazing.
Yeah. And I will also say this, though. Skyward Sword, if you haven't played it, there's probably more of a likelihood that you haven't played Skyward Sword for anyone listening that hasn't played it. I would say that's a must-play between and you can finish it easily between now and Breath of the Wild. And I would think, I mean, Ocarina of Time is a must-play. If there's three Zelda titles, it's I think you should do Skyward Sword, Ocarina of Time, and then I do think Wind Waker should be the third if you have three Zeldas played by Breath of the Wild, because I think Ocarina of Time just lays the groundwork for Hyrule in a way that's never been done, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Skyward Sword is the Genesis story, and I think Wind Waker especially tells such a it's kind of like a good
it's the apocalyptic story, I think, in a way, because it's the whole world's kind of been flooded and it's way post. It's kind of like going from the middle to the beginning to the very end, and then this Breath of the Wild seems like going like prehistory almost or something, or like way ancient history, like way past or something, further 100 years into the future or something, you know. It's like
And also just for the sake, like, because the reason I say Wind Waker and not, you know, Majora's Mask or Twilight Princess is simply because, you know, Ocarina of Time, Majora's Mask, and Twilight Princess are a trilogy. Like, it follows the same link in the same timeline, really back to back to back. Like, you see, well, I mean, Twilight Princess is a little bit farther down the line, but you see the link of Ocarina of Time and Twilight Princess. He comes back. Like, it's it's his story. But
well, I think I made, oh, sorry, go ahead.
I was just going to say, but when Breath of the Wild seems to be taking lots more Wind Waker influence, and I wouldn't be surprised if at the end of the day, Breath of the Wild is 100 years after the Wind Waker timeline.
Yeah, well, that's what I was thinking. I think that I made that prediction way back, is that I think that this is, like, set way, way after, and that there's been something that really bad happened, and that everything's kind of become reset in a way. That the old Hyrule has almost become an Atlantean sort of ancient place that, like, it's kind of to the point where, you know, technology did grow, but then everything gets reset in some sort of disaster, which probably is the Calamity Ganon story or something like that, where there was a lot of ancient technologies that were from previous timeline. Things have just been endlessly recycling. It's just kind of, I don't know, I love that about Zelda and about franchises like this and Star Wars and stuff, and how they do these super universal human themes that, like, they echo with us, and, like, they are part of the core of our human beings, and it's amazing. And that's why I think Zelda Breath of the Wild is, like, the most hyped game, one of the most hyped games of all time. So
yeah, it's gonna be legit. I can't wait.
We
get to play it in 7 weeks, less than 2 months. We're playing on the Nintendo Switch with Breath. Like, Zach, we got our pre-order. We are going to be playing the Switch with Breath of the Wild in just a few weeks. Like, we guys got to make it through February, then we're done.
Yeah.
Like, once it's February 1st, and I'm like, oh, whoa, like, in 4 weeks, I'm going to be playing the Switch. And the nice thing is it seems like they're doing the whole future-proofing thing, which Sony and Xbox are also doing. It seems like this is just Nintendo now. Like, they're basing so much of their stuff and their connectivity in smartphones and applications and online infrastructure and a service almost, and tying all that stuff to your account, similar to what PlayStation and Xbox are doing, to the point where, you know, Switch 2 comes out and you just keep moving forward now. Like, this is... It's not, okay, what happens now? You know, I've got my Wii U. Is it discs or whatever? Like, it's all going to be cartridge-based probably now moving forward, little SD cards, or just a digital future.
Yeah.
You know, it's just, we've arrived at Nintendo's future.
It
feels so good.
I have a couple points to make before we head out. One thing is about Pokemon Stars. I made that prediction that I think that we'd get it announced. But I do think, my feeling, thinking about it a bit longer, is that I feel they just had their launch of Sun and Moon. Most likely, Stars would be announced a little bit later, I feel, or if it was going to be released, maybe it'd be the later in the year or early next year for the sort of third in the series to kind of let Sun and Moon simmer a bit. And also, I would assume, since they spent so much time, like, wrapping up Sun and Moon, perhaps they're not even ready with, like, the updated graphics and updated slight engine tweaks and things they want to do to actually put a presentation together that would be worth, like, be ready in time for what they had last night. So I'm suspecting that perhaps that if that's still coming, which hopefully I would think that it's inevitable that now, since you say, like, now it's all going to cartridges, they still have the portability factor. Why not? It seems inevitable that Pokemon will have to come to the Switch eventually. So I just think that we're a little bit further out from that. And the second point I wanted to make was about the Wii U and the 3DS. I think that people have been a little skeptical about the launch lineup for the Switch and how light it seems with only a few games. And there's Breath of the Wild, which is really amazing. But otherwise, and then we're getting some ports later. It's like this launch window for some people is not looking too spectacular, especially when you can get Breath of the Wild on the Wii U if you really want to. It's nothing like... I would say that that's totally valid, but also keep in mind that I think that this is what Nintendo does now, is what they're super smart in that. I think that you can be you can be confident that with the 3DS, like, sure, that had a kind of a lackluster launch with some light titles, but look at what it became. Like, look at what, in the year after, the immediate following year, it blew up to where 3DS became a frenzy of people. Everybody wanted one and everybody got one. And it seems the Wii U also got to kind of that point where maybe it had a slightly lackluster light launch titles with New Super Mario Bros. U and stuff, and then maybe some Ubisoft games and
Ubisoft.
But but then the years after, I think the Wii U really proved itself. I think the Switch will do it even more because we're actually getting like the Mario 64. We're getting the Zelda right off the bat. That the Wii U never really got, because we only got like ports on the Wii U of Zelda games. We never got our official like brand new one. So I feel like this is gonna be the time where, and especially since it's merging of everything that's gonna be coming to 3DS, will most likely be switching to the Switch and everything that would be Wii U. Like, to merge these ecosystems together, it's gonna be like the perfect storm, where I think that definitely, like, sure, like, wait till a price drop maybe for Black Friday deals, or wait till the next year. I think that if you're the diehard fan and you want to support Nintendo and let them know that you're confident in the console and know that games are going to be coming, more games that are all going to be quality, like, just wait for E3 and stuff. I bet we're going to get announcements that are just mind-blowing, and
what the thing is, that gonna be so hype.
I think people need to consider that it's about quality and not quantity, and that Nintendo, it seems, are really working towards the quality. Like, Breath of the Wild seems they really made sure it was a quality game. Super Mario Odyssey, it seems like it's complete quality. Experience, all like the,
and it's consistent too. Like, it's monthly releases for the next year. Like, that's the big thing that we've talked about in the past. It's no longer okay, a Wii U game this month, a 3DS game this month, a Wii U game this month, right, a 3DS game this month. Like, and you know, save a few, like, and then 1 month there's no games, but then there's two in the holiday. Like, it's just the Switch now. So it's gonna be Switch. Like, they're this year they're knocking out the ports. When else are they gonna put out Mario Kart? They have to put out Mario Kart this year. They can't wait for next year to put out Mario Kart.
Right.
So they're gonna go ahead and get that port out of the way. They're gonna go ahead and get Zelda out of the way, because that's the first game that's done. Super Mario Odyssey makes sense, because they need to get that. They're gonna immediately release that Splatoon sequel. Then next year you're probably gonna see Smash Bros, Super Mario Maker, you know. And then if it has a 5-year life cycle, it's just going to be monthly consistent games where they're just going to go through all of their IP. It's going to be the software I'm not worried about at all with the Switch. Even if no third party developers jump on board, them saying that they have Zelda, Mario Kart, Splatoon, and Mario in the first year without even doing an E3 conference, like, that's just the initial press conference for the console.
Yeah.
I mean, people are freaking out, you know, with PlayStation saying, oh, those PlayStation games. And granted, PlayStation has a ton of exclusives. I'm not denying that. But you have a show like E3 where they say all these games and they really do the smoke and mirrors thing. Those games aren't coming out for years. Like, this stuff's coming out this year, and it's going to be fun.
Yeah.
And if you missed out on the Wii U, which most people did because the Wii U didn't sell that well, Mario Kart is a new game for them. Mm-hmm. You know, Zelda is a new game for them.
Yeah, that's a good point.
And Splatoon is a new game for them. Like, they didn't play Splatoon because most of these people that the Switch is appealing to never even had a Wii U. So this is, it's, you know, it's all new to them. And so in that sense, imagine if you had never played Splatoon or Mario Kart 8 before, and you're getting those this year. Like, that would be, oh my gosh.
Yeah.
Then it's definitely worth it. So it's really only a problem if you had a Wii U, which if you had a Wii U, you are in the minority. So
I just think I think there's that to consider, and I think that a lot of people didn't consider that with like the Wii U and stuff, with how, and with the 3DS initially, with how good Nintendo is at consistent quality and putting those titles out, to where, like, you're gonna miss out on some of the stuff. You wanna maybe get on board if you're really about Nintendo, and get on it so that you can be in the loop and get ahead on some of these like free bonuses and free offers and deals that they're giving out, so that you can be like, and sometimes they'll put out like ambassador programs that you can never get anywhere else, and you get a whole bunch of free exclusive things. So yeah, really put the support in there, because Nintendo, it seems, always provide in giving amazing experiences, and maybe they're not. They're like, maybe only a few are there right off the bat, but then it's just year after year of just bang after bang, and it seems like just got the Xbox One, and I can't even really name more than maybe one or two titles that are coming out in the next year that are exclusive and really of that much interest to me. So
The four I mentioned are all exclusives too. Like, it's not even like, you know, some other people have mentioned online, you know, you got Call of Duty on the PlayStation 4 launch, you got these games, but those aren't exclusive. Like, these are, you got to get a Switch if you want to play Zelda. You got to get a, I mean, I guess if you have a Wii U, but you have to get a Nintendo console if you want to play Zelda. You have to get a Nintendo console if you want to play Mario Kart. Like, and that's why we're a Nintendo podcast. We're going to stick with them till the day we die.
Yep.
But we'll also critique them and say that ARMS should have been a Punch-Out game. Just saying. But no, thank you so much for listening to Kopai Podcast Episode 43. I did want to say that Pokemon X and Y launched in 2013, and then 1 month later, Super Mario 3D World also launched. So it's not out of the question to maybe have an E3 or just a separate Pokemon Direct or something that says Stars comes out, and it comes out right around Super Mario, because it happened last time. So maybe we'll get a Pokemon this year. I'm just waiting for Animal Crossing Switch, because then my life will be perfect, where I can take my Animal Crossing Village with me wherever I go. So there's lots more stuff to talk about with Switch, lots more hype. We're going to have separate Zelda discussions and a Mario discussion in the upcoming weeks as we lead up to the Nintendo Switch. It's only 7 weeks away. We have ours pre-ordered alongside our Zelda collectors, so we'll get unboxing videos for those. Zach, what were you going to say?
I just kind of had a mind-blowing thought. Like, what if... Yeah, they have this Switch docking station, right? What if they release, like they had the Super Game Boy, where you could put your cartridges, your Game Boy cartridges in there? Like, what if they released a peripheral that's like just kind of a case that is like designed to be shaped like the Switch, but puts 3DS cartridges in, and you just dock it into that docking station, and then it puts it on the TV screen, 3DS games or something like that.
Well, someone may just figure that out, like to do it separately.
Yeah. Let's do it.
Well, you can design it. It's probably super easy. Well, I'm thinking even like, you know, you don't need a PlayStation 4 Pro version of the Switch. You just get a stronger docking station. You know, you get a stronger screen.
Yeah.
You can do a whole new screen, but keep the Joy-Cons, and they can just attach the side. And that'll, you can make a whole new screen for $100, you know.
Mm-hmm.
The pro version of Switch for $150, it's just the tablet, you put your Joy-Cons on. If you want a whole bundle, that's $500. But if you already have 20 Joy-Cons, you're good to go. You know, where PlayStation, they have to sell everything all together because it's all in one box. The Switch is spread out across so much that the only thing they need to upgrade is just the tablet now moving forward. It's, oh man, it's such a good time to be Kopai, such a good time to be alive. My Nintendo News is over here tweeting out things. The aftermath of the Switch, some new stuff to talk about. We'll have to talk about it next week. So much is happening. We're going to have a wealth of stuff to talk about. We're going to make up just little spreadsheets of all the information and check off things you've talked about on Kopai. Something, I don't know. But be sure, if you are watching this archived, you can watch Kopai Podcast live every Friday at 11 a.m. Central Time. That's 9 a.m. Pacific Time and noon Eastern Time in North America. I don't know all the other time zones in Europe and Germany. I'm sorry. You guys will probably be some of the people that view us, actually, because it'll probably be lining up with your dinner time and all of that to actually watch us. So I probably should figure out your time zones, but we live stream every Friday morning. It's a Nintendo morning show, and we're gonna be doing that every single week now. That's our new schedule. We also live stream video games every Monday, Wednesday, Friday, from 9 to 10 a.m. Central Time in North America. And so if you guys want to come and hang out with us as we play games, sometimes Zach will be tuning in via Skype, other times it'll just be me. But we'll also turn those as Let's Plays and put them over on youtube.com/KopaiGaming, where you can watch this podcast as well as podcast services around the world. Thank you so much for listening, Zach. Thank you so much for tuning in via Skype. You got your little me down there with your hype Zelda shirt. I changed you into that so you could be all excited. Maybe one day we'll get you a nice HD webcam and we can set up our little studio and be talking. I need to get a screen behind me, and I also need to figure out something with these glare on my glasses before Chariot God wins down the comments saying, Kaz, you got a glare on your glasses. I know it's there. I don't know what to do. I don't know how to fix it. What am I supposed to do? Just take off my glasses? Then I can't see anything. Sheesh. People. Can't please them. Don't know what to do. I guess I could turn off my monitor, but then I don't see anything. Yeah, it's just bad. But yeah, thank you so much for listening to Kobai Podcast. My tummy disgruntled because I need to go have lunch. And until next week.